has got a doctorate in philosophy from the University of Manchester. He has written extensively, including on self-knowledge, ethical relativism, discovering Shia Islam, Shi'i Islam, origins, faith and practices and principles of jurisprudence. He is also co-editor of Catholics and Shia in Dialogue, Studies in Theology and Spirituality and Catholic Shia Engagement. Sheikh Shomali.
Thank you. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah al-Aliyy al-Azim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Sallallahu ala sayyidina wa nabiyyina wa abil qasim al-Mustafa Muhammad. Wa ala alihi al-tayyibin al-tahirin. La siyama baqiyatillahi fil aradin. Ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif. وجعلنا من أعوانه وأنصاره وشيعته إن شاء الله. Trusting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we start our series of talk on the globe before and after the advent of Imam Mahdi, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. And inshallah, I hope with your comments and with your inshallah active engagement in this discussion, inshallah we will all benefit, and inshallah not only we will increase our knowledge, but also inshallah we will increase our remembrance of our Imam Mahdi ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. And because this inshallah series of lecture is very much interlinked and interrelated, so it's very important, and I appreciate if brothers and sisters could follow up all the talks, and if for some reason they cannot come some night, at least they can maybe listen it. I don't know if it will be available soon, so that inshallah there will be no gap in the way that the lecture proceeds. What we are going, inshallah, to talk about is to see what is the Islamic picture of the future of humanity. What is the Islamic projection about what is happening in end of time, in Akhir al-Zaman. I will, inshallah, refer to pictures that are drawn by other religions and also by some philosophers of history, but our main focus would be on the Islamic perspective in this regard. And you know, this is a very important topic. There are hundreds of hadiths in which the issue of Akhir al-Zaman, which literally means end of time, has been discussed. And this issue is also very much related to the issue of Imam Mahdi, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. So, inshallah, what we are going to do is that today I will, inshallah, give you some general ideas, some conceptual frame for the discussion, inshallah, that we are going to have. And I clarify the meaning of Akhir al-Zaman, and inshallah, then the next would be to talk about Akhir al-Zaman in other religions. And then, inshallah, based on hadith and the Quran, but the main source that we have here is hadith, which goes into further details. We will talk about what is going to happen, or maybe has already started happening in Akhir al-Zaman, in respect to intellectual condition of human being. Can we say that human beings are improving in their understanding or not? Are they in decline or no? They are improving. About science, about technology, about the general cultural situation, about moral situation. It's very important what is the situation before the time of Imam and after the time of Imam. What is the situation of humanity in respect to religiosity? Can we say people in Akhir al-Zaman are more religious or less religious, or we cannot generalize? So inshallah we will talk about all these matters based on hadith. I don't want to philosophize that much, because the best thing is to refer to the people who have the knowledge, and that's the Prophet and Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam. And as the Quran says, fas'alu ahla dhikr in kuntum la ta'lamun. And in this very subject we are very much ignorant, because we have not been through this experience, we have not been to the end of the time, so that we can come and narrate to other people what is going to happen. Okay, so this is basically what inshallah we are going to do. And about the significance of the subject, we should know that this is very much a human subject. I don't think that you can find any human being who does not think about his future or her future as a person, and also the future of human generation. Whenever we have time, or whenever we, you know, are faced with some, you know, difficulties, or maybe even with some joyful, you know, news, we think, what is going to happen? Is it going to remain the same? Is it going to become better or worse? What will happen after we die? What will happen to our progeny, to other human beings? This is something, it's very much human to think about the future. And I don't think you can find any religion, any school of thought that has not addressed this issue of future. And this is part of the eschatology that they have, about the future. Of course, some have very detailed account about the future, like we Muslims. We have very detailed account of future, but some may not have. But I don't think there is anyone who has been silent about the future. And as far as we know, as far as the people who have done very scholarly research, they have also, you know, confirmed, most of the time religions have very positive view about future. Inshallah, I'm going to mention about some religions. We don't know any religion which says that we have a very pessimistic picture about the future. Overall, the picture that they have about the future is positive. That the end of the history of humanity would be joyful. And normally, they all say that before that there would be lots of problems and difficulties and calamities. But in the end, the story ends with you know, joy and with happiness. This is very general pattern. But this is about religions. About philosophers, no. Some philosophers are very pessimistic, some philosophers are optimistic. But divine religions, especially those which are based on revelation, they share this idea of having a savior and having prosperity in the end for human beings. When it comes to Islam, we have, as I said, very detailed and very sophisticated account about Akhir al-Zaman. And the late Shahid Sadr, he has a discussion, Bahsun Hawl al-Mahdi, Ajjalallah Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif, and he says, you can rarely find any Islamic subject that has been so much discussed and so much emphasized on in Islamic hadith narrated by all Islamic schools of thought, not only Shia. And he mentions that there are more than 400 hadiths from the Prophet, all narrated by Sunni scholars about Imam Mahdi, Ajjalallah Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif. And a very good book, a very scholarly work has been done by Ayatollah Safi Gulpaygani, who is himself now one of Maraji, and his son-in-law of Ayatollah Gulpaygani, Rahmatullah Alayhi. He was one of the best students of Ayatollah Burujerdi. So he has done a very good work called Muntakhab al-Athar. And this was with the guidance and under supervision of Ayatollah Buruzerdi, who was expert in Shia and Sunni fiqh and hadith. So he has referred to more than 6,000, indeed 6,207 hadith about Imam Mahdi. 6,207 hadith about Imam Mahdi narrated in more than 157 early books by Shia and Sunni. And his book is very well classified and it's available in Arabic and Farsi, but I don't think it still is available in English, unfortunately. And interestingly, this issue is well attended even before the time of Imam Mahdi and before the time of Ghaiba, because it started from the time of the Prophet, and then all other Imams emphasized on this issue. And for example, we have some books and some collections of hadith about Imam Mahdi long time before the birth of Imam Mahdi. For example, there is a famous Shia narrator of hadith called Hassan ibn Mahbub, Hassan the son of Mahbub. He has written a book called Al-Mashikha. And in this book, he mentions hadith about Imam Mahdi. And this is about more than a century before the time of Ghaiba. So this issue is very well attended by all Islamic schools of thought. So the hope that is that by addressing this issue, by studying this issue, we have good chance of also touching upon some commonality between all Muslims. It's not a Shia subject, it's an Islamic subject, it's something that should bring all Muslims together. And the other thing which is very much important is that, inshallah, as you will see, by reading and reflecting, more important than reading is reflecting on these hadiths, we somehow can get some maybe policies, some strategies from these hadiths. What should we do in Akhirul Zaman to prepare ourselves, to protect ourselves, to enable ourselves to serve this great cause? So there are lots of practical implications involved. And people who are clever, the people who are insightful, can understand many, many things. So just I convey this to you, but you may understand better than me, as we have in hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, نذر الله عبدا سمع مقالتي فدعاها وبلغه الى من لم يسمعها. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make prosperous and happy the one who listens to my hadith, understands the hadith, and then convey this to others. Then the Prophet said, رب حامل فقه غير فقيه رب حامل فقه الى من هو افقه من. There are people who carry some piece of knowledge, but they themselves don't understand. They just pass it on to other people. And there are people who understand, but they pass it to the people who understand even more. So maybe, inshallah, you, inshallah, understand things that when you make, you know, your comments, I can, inshallah, learn from you. Okay, let's start with description of Akhiru Zaman. What does Akhiru Zaman mean? In Arabic, there are two terms which are very similar, and sometimes people get confused. One is akhir, the other is akhir. So it is akhiru zaman, not akharu zaman. Akhir in Arabic means other. Akhir means other. But akhir means end. Okay? So akhiru zaman means end of the time. What does it mean? End of the time. If you read hadith, you find many cases in which Akhiru Zaman is used. As I said, hundreds of cases.
I think that there are two main usage of the term akhir zaman in hadith. One is a period of time in which Islam appeared, started as the last message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till day of resurrection, till end of the life on this world for human beings. This is a very common usage of akhir zaman. So the time of Jahiliyyah, and then the great need for a prophet to come and bring the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came, and this continued. This is why you find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in many hadith, even in the tongue of Musa or Isa, is introduced as the Prophet of akhir zaman. Our Prophet is introduced as Prophet of akhir zaman. Okay? The second usage is a more limited, a much more shorter period. When our Prophet himself talks about akhir zaman, or our Imams talk about akhir zaman, normally they mean something even shorter. And that is the time before the advent of Imam Mahdi and after that. Okay? So it's ending part of the time of Ghaibah, the very last part of the time of the occultation of Imam Zaman. So you see, there are two different usage of the term, but they are very much related to each other. Why? Because the ending part is the same. You know, if you have this, for example, whole life of human being on the planet, okay, I don't know how many years. If you have all this as a line, starting with, for example, the Prophet Adam, and then ending with the resurrection, okay? You can say this part is the last part of this line, and you can say this part is the last part of this line. Both is correct. It's according to your point of reference. But what is important is that this part must be the same. You cannot say this is last part of the time and this is last part of the time. No. But you can say this is last part of the time or this is last part of the time. The only thing you need to consider is that this part cannot be larger than the other part. So what we understand is that from the time of the Prophet till end of the life of human beings must be shorter than the time before Islam. Is it clear? So what has passed before must be much longer than this. And this is why it is true to say this is end of time. Okay? Is it clear? So for example, if, I don't know, if it is supposed to pass 14 centuries, 15 centuries, I don't know, 20 centuries after the Prophet of Islam, till resurrection starts. So the period before that must be much longer. Okay, is it clear? There are two hadiths. I haven't seen these hadiths in Shia sources, but I have seen it in some Shia sources, but they have narrated from Sunni sources. So I haven't seen it myself in original in Shia sources. I am still doing research on this. But this hadith, for example, one is in Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there is no that much distance between me and Qiyamah, the day of judgment. And he said, the distance or the relation between me and Qiyamah is like these two fingers, is next to each other. This is, as I said, in Sahih Muslim. There is another hadith in which the Prophet told his companions that was before sunset. It's nearly when the time of Qurub. And the Prophet said, our situation in the whole time span is like this. So the period after us compared to the period before us is like the time that is left from the day compared to whole day before. Okay? I haven't seen this in Shia sources originally, so I cannot confirm it is really so short or not. But just to give you some idea that this period cannot be anyway logically longer than the period before. So, inshallah, it will not take that much time, you know, till Imam Zaman, inshallah, comes. Now let me read for you some hadith in which the Prophet of Islam is introduced as the Prophet of Akhir al-Zaman. The Prophet Musa, ala nabiyyina wa alihi wa alayhi salam, said, إِذَا كَانَ آخِرُ الزَّمَانِ يَخْرُجُ نَبِيٌّ يُقَالُ لَهُ أَحْمَدُ صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. He said, when آخر الزمان comes, a prophet would come who is called Ahmad. Because you know, the Prophet of Islam, his name is also Ahmad. And as the Quran says that, مُبَشِّرًا بِرَسُولٍ يَأْتِي مِنْ بَعْدِ اسْمُهُ أَحْمَدُ خاتم الانبياء. He would be the seal of the prophets. لا نبي بعده. There would be no prophet after him. And يخرج من صلبه أئمة أبرار. From his progeny there would be righteous imams. عدد الأسباط. The number would be equal to the number of the أسباط, is 12. So the Prophet Musa mentioned that the Prophet of Islam as Prophet of Akhir al-Zaman. Another case is mentioned by the late Sheikh Saduq, a great muhaddis of Shia, in Ilal al-Shara'ih, volume 1, page 55. He mentions a conversation between Yusuf and Zuleika after all those problems and after the death of Pharaoh, all those things. Yusuf asked Zuleika, ما الذي دعاك يا زليخا دعاك يا زليخا إلى ما كان منك. What did cause all these things, you know, creating all these problems, you know, for me? She said, حسن وجهك يا يوسف. You were very beautiful. And this caused problems. Then Yusuf said, كيف لو رأيت نبياً يقال له محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم يكون في آخر الزمان أحسن مني وجها. So what would you feel if you see the prophet who comes in آخر الزمان, his name is Muhammad and he's more beautiful than me, وأحسن مني خلقا, and his character is better than me, وأسمح مني كفا, and he's more generous than me. Then Zuleika said, Sadaqta, you are right. Then Yusuf told, how did you know? How did he know this? Zuleika said, لَأَنَّكَ حِينَ ذَكَرْتَهُ وَقَعَ حُبُّهُ فِي قَلْبِ. Because as soon as you mentioned his name, I felt love for him. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Yusuf that she is honest. She's telling this, you know, as, you know, an honest and real story. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked Yusuf to get married to Zuleika. This is in Ilal al-Shara'ih by the late Sheikh Saduq, volume 1, page 55. What is important, and my point of reference, is that he refers to the Prophet of Islam as the Prophet of Akhir al-Zaman. There are many hadiths about Prophet Isa referring to our Prophet, about Prophet of Akhir al-Zaman. So this is very, as I said, very common usage to say and to apply Akhir al-Zaman to the time just before the advent of Islam and after that till end of the
life of this generation of human being and when the Day of Judgment starts. The second, which would be indeed our main topic, is the period much after that. The period in the time of Qaybah, when things radically change, and then Imam Zaman alayhi salam would come and would bring justice, fair distribution of all resources, lots of improvements, which inshallah we are going to mention. This is the second usage. And this is our main topic. Okay? So, but you should remember there are two ways of using the term Akhir al-Zaman, and as I said, both of them are correct. And the reason is that both of them refer to ending part of the lifespan of human beings. I would like to refer to a story that all of you know. Again, about our Prophet. And the more we talk about our Prophet, inshallah, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would enlighten our heart. You know the story of that monk that met the Prophet when he was young and, you know, for a trade business, you know, he was going. And that monk had a conversation with two people who were in the same group that the Prophet was. When he was talking to them, the Prophet came. Then this man started talking in private to the Prophet. And then after some conversation, he started kissing between two eyes of the Prophet. And he brought something out, but these people say we don't know what he had. The Prophet didn't kiss him. They say the Prophet didn't kiss him, but he kissed between the eyes of the Prophet. And then he told us, "Haza wallahi nabiyyu akhir az-zaman." By Allah, this is the Prophet of akhir az-zaman. This is the monk who met the Prophet when the Prophet was still young. And he said, "Wallahi sayakhruju qariban." Soon this man will be commissioned by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will invite people toward the religion of Allah. فَيَدْعُ النَّاسِ إِلَىٰ شَهَادَةِ اللَّهِ إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. He would call people towards the unity of Allah to declare that there is no God but Allah. فَإِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ ذَلِكَ فَاتَّبِعُوهُ. If you witness this time, if you see him that he's doing this, follow him. This is what that monk said. So, as I said, this was a very established idea that this would be the Prophet of Akhir al-Zaman. And indeed, you know, do you know why so many Jewish tribes migrated to Medina and settled there? What was the reason? The reason was that because of their knowledge, because of the sources that they had, they knew that there would be Prophet of Akhir al-Zaman coming in this area. So they all went there so that they can be there and witness this event and enjoy the support of that Prophet and, you know, protection of that Prophet and whatsoever. But unfortunately, when the Prophet came, instead of supporting the Prophet and believing in the Prophet and accepting his message, it was not beneficial for them, so they didn't believe in the Prophet. And this is why the Quran, you know, complains and said, the Prophet that you yourself were waiting for him, and you had all the details about him, when he came, you didn't believe in him. So this is about the Prophet of Akhir al-Zaman. I give you some idea, just a few minutes. This can be, inshallah, in your mind. And this will help a lot for our coming discussions about
the second usage of Akhir al-Zaman. And that is end of my talk today. The period, the second usage. The period before the advent of Imam Mahdi and after the advent of Mahdi, this period, the last part of Ghaibah. According to our hadith, in this period, there would be lots of problems, especially lots of moral problems. The people who are doing mischief would increase in quantity and in quality. So the mischief which is being done in this period would be much more than mischief in any other period, in quantity and in quality. There would be some types of sins in this period that was not being performed at all in the past, or it was very rare, but it becomes very common in this period. Collapse of relations between families, relations in the society, collapse of respect, many, many things like this, inshallah, we are going to mention. Lots of deviations and distortion of the faith would happen in this period. And the army of evil, the army of Shaitan, the Shaitan and his people, would be more in quantity than the people who follow the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? But, inshallah, you will see that in quality, there would be people in this period, in the army of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are much more stronger than most of the believers in any other time. Even much more stronger than the believers in the time of the prophets. So, if I want to summarize this in just one sentence, is that both armies of good and evil will reach their climax. They will reach their top. Okay? You would never have such a flourishment in the army of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as you have it in Akhir al-Zaman. And also you would never have such an expansion in quantity and also strength and progress in quality for the army of Shaitan. So they all reach their top. But the army of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be victorious and would win because of the quality, not because of the quantity. Qualitatively, they're much more stronger. And this is why they win. So inshallah we will talk about it, but I wanted to give you some idea so that you can inshallah put whatever you hear in a big general, you know, conceptual framework. I think I stop tonight here, and if there is any question, then inshallah I will be more than happy to answer. Tomorrow, as I said, inshallah we will talk about the issue of Akhir al-Zaman in some other religions, and then inshallah after that we go further into details about Islamic perspective.
The question and answer will come later?
Yes.
After the month?
Yes. Yeah. Alhamdulillah, we are fortunate enough that we have been able to witness this Muharram again, and there have been brothers and sisters, you know, who were maybe with us here or in other, you know, parts of the world,
that the last Muharram was their last Muharram, really last Muharram. So Alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have been given this chance to witness another Muharram, and inshallah by learning more about the teachings of Ahlul Bayt and learning more about the causes for which Imam Hussein alayhi salam and his companions were sacrificed, inshallah we will become even more closer to them. And in this Muharram we need to do lots of dua inshallah, because we are living in a very important time, very critical and crucial time. And I think the whole world, especially the Muslim Ummah and more especially the Shia community, are very much in need of dua. We must inshallah do dua and ask inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to inshallah bring inshallah peace and security to the whole world inshallah. The relation between the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein was very outstanding, and it was not difficult for any Muslim who lived in Medina to understand that these two are very beloved by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had wisely planned that the Prophet would not have any son himself. So his progeny had to continue through the Lady Fatima. And so Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein were the sons of the Prophet, not just like a grandchildren. They were just sons of the Prophet. And this is very important. And the way that the Prophet treated them was very special. Being a prophet, and not only ordinary prophet, Khatamul Anbiya, and then in front of anyone, respecting Hassan and Hussein and kissing Hassan and Hussein. Sometimes the Prophet was on minbar and coming down from minbar, stopping his speech, and then showing his love to Imam Hassan or Imam Hussein. And even you have heard this, that when Imam Hussein alayhi salam was very young, he wanted to say his prayer behind the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in jama'ah. And when the Prophet said Allahu Akbar, Imam Hussein was very young child. So he couldn't say Allahu Akbar. Then Jibreel asked the Prophet to repeat. So the Prophet said again Allahu Akbar, and up to 7 times. And then this became sunnah. Even if you open any risala today, it said that this is mustahab to say Takbiratul Ihram 7 times. When did this start? This started when Imam Hussein, as a small child, was in this jama'ah and he wanted to say Allahu Akbar, but he couldn't. And finally, in the 7th time, he said Allahu Akbar. And this made everyone love Hussein saying Allahu Akbar. So in Medina, people, when met Imam Hussein as a child, they were all asking him, Hussein, please say Allahu Akbar. And they were all enjoying. And of course, more than anyone else, the family of Imam Ali, Lady Fatima, Lady Zainab were enjoying. But what happened is very, shocking. How the people of Medina, who all knew such a position that Hussein had in the eyes of the Prophet, and lots of hadith that all Muslims have narrated that say Al-Hasan wa al-Husayn Sayyida Shabab Ahlul Jannah. Husaynun minni wa ana min Husayn. Many, many things. What happened that just as soon as the Prophet died, then people started forgetting this? Or if they didn't forget, they didn't understand it. They didn't get the point. You know, sometimes you don't forget, but you don't understand. You can literally, you know, say, but your mind doesn't work. Once a Jewish man told Imam Ali alayhi salam, he was trying, you know, to somehow criticize Muslims. So he said, what happened to you that as soon as your prophet died, you started disagreeing each other? And because Imam Ali alayhi salam was very much careful about Islamic unity, so he wanted to tell him, no, we are not that much divided. The Prophet said, we have disagreement not about our Prophet, but we have disagreement about how to understand the teachings of our Prophet. This is very important. We never dispute about the Prophet. No Muslim has ever disputed about the Prophet. Just the fact is how to understand what he said. But you yourself, as soon as you crossed Nile and your prophet was still with you and you saw the miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as soon as you crossed the Nile, you said, we want an idol. اجعل لنا إلها كما لهم آلهة, because they saw some people who are worshipping idols and they were reminded of their past. So said, oh Musa, please create for us some idols. We want to worship idols. So Imam Ali said, so you cannot complain us. At least we are loyal to our Prophet, and this is only the domestic issue. This is a family problem between we Muslims. So what I am saying is that despite the fact that the old Muslims were loyal to the Prophet, but unfortunately their mind of some Muslims were idled or were not that much, you know, getting the points. What was the reason that the Prophet showed lots of love and respect in front of everyone to this family? And what was the reason that he said, Husaynun minni wa ana min Husayn? And even there are hadiths in Sunni sources that the Prophet himself predicted the martyrdom of Imam Hussein. And for example, there is a hadith that the lady Umm Salameh said that the Prophet told me about the martyrdom of Hussein and gave me a small, you know, bottle, glass bottle or jar. And there was some soil. I said, this is what Jibreel has brought to me, and when Hussein is killed, this becomes red. This is in Sunni sources. So everyone was looking at Hussein, and this is, I think, very sad for the family of the Prophet. Looking at Hussein, but always remembering the tragic event which is going to happen to Hussein. It said that when the Prophet was very ill and just before he passed away, the Prophet saw Imam Hussein alayhi salam, Hussein was there. And the Prophet took Hussein in his hand and made Hussein touch him. And I started crying. Said, Mali wali Yazid, la barakallahu fi. What does Yazid want from me? Hussein was still, you know, less than 10 years old, you know, 7 years old. So the Prophet was remembering what is going to happen to Imam Hussein. He said, Mali wali Yazid. What does Yazid want from me? What has Yazid to do with me? May Allah not bless him. La barakallahu fi. Allahumma al-an Yazid. Then the Prophet went unconscious. Again the Prophet became conscious and his eyes were full of tears and started kissing Hussein and said, Ama inna li wa liqatilika maqaman bayna yaday Allah azza wa jal. Beware that in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala there would be a case between me and your murderer. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be the judge and I would be the one who would claim for your blood and your murderer has to be responsible. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshallah enable us to do proper inshallah mourning and azadari in this Muharram. May Allah inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all human beings, all Muslims, all the Shia community, and may this Muharram inshallah would be a very blessed Muharram for everyone. And inshallah, if here or you know when at home you are doing Ziyarat Ashura or you know you have any chance, please remember each other, pray for each other, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshallah to forgive us and inshallah to make our Imam Zaman happy with us. I hope that inshallah now that we have dedicated our Muharram to Imam Zaman, inshallah Imam Zaman would inshallah have a special attention inshallah to our majlis and inshallah we would benefit inshallah from the provision of Imam Zaman. Ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. Thank you very much for your attention. Allah.